When I first started in business, I'll even start before then. Before I was in business at all, I knew nothing at all about business. Like, my whole dream in life was to have a TV show. And so I had a job, I took a job where I was interviewing prostitutes for a living. And I would have to walk up to these people at like 3 or 4 in the morning on like a Wednesday night, and it'd be, you know, they're on the job, so you can't really bother them too much, but within like 10 seconds, 15 seconds, I'd have to get them to feel comfortable enough to open up to me. And then I'd have to really quickly ask them questions like, what are you doing? And I'd have to listen carefully to, get an interesting story for them or get from them or get their background and not just get like the typical answers. So, because everyone's going to start off hating you if you just walk up to them when they're at their job and you start talking to them. And yeah, prostitution is a viable job at 3 in the morning for many of these women. So, or drug dealers I was talking to, or all sorts of people. And none of them liked me in those first 5 seconds. So I had another 5 seconds to get them to like me, or else they would start throwing things at me. And that happened quite a few times. I'd have to like run away because people would be throwing things at me, and or worse. And so I did this for many years, and I got kind of good at, first off, when I started doing this, I was really scared. Like, how am I gonna walk up to any stranger and talk to them? Have you ever just walked up to a stranger and started talking to them and try, like, sometimes you ask for directions and that's a kind of a normal social thing. But if you just walk up to people and say, did you get divorced last year? They're probably gonna not like you so much. They're probably not gonna answer. And it's an awkward thing. I'll just tell you a little side story. A friend of mine and I challenged each other about 2 months ago. Okay, we know from scientific studies, it's very good to like hug people. So the challenge is, we're gonna go up to complete strangers and hug them, or convince them to hug us for 30 seconds or more. And I challenge all of you to try this at least once. It's very difficult. Like, so I figured, okay, no problem, we'll do this, and I'll be a pro. Like, I talked to prostitutes for 3 years, I could at least get someone to hug me. So the first time I tried, it worked. I was with a friend of mine, and we're walking in the street, and this guy's passing, he's listening to his, I was about to say Walkman, but that doesn't exist anymore. He's listening to something. And I say, listen, can I hug you? And he's like, sure. And so I put my arms around him, and, you know, after like 5 seconds, he's like, is that good? And I'm like, no, and I like hugged him tighter. And after about 20 seconds, he's like, I've really got to get to work. And after 30 seconds, finally, I let him go. And this gave me this false sense of confidence that, oh, it's easier than I thought. And then the next 10 times I asked people if I could hug them, they were like, get the hell away. I'm not letting you touch me. And so so it's been 2 months since my friend and I have done this challenge, and I've hugged 2 people in that time, which is a real disappointment. I haven't even called my friend because I'm embarrassed about this. I'm assuming he's hugging people every day. So we'll find out. You've just reminded me I gotta call him. I avoid doing that. So about a year ago, almost to the day, I was on this plane. I was on JetBlue coming from California to here. And the guy, you never want to talk to the guy sitting next to you on the plane, particularly if it's like on a red eye. What are you gonna do? You're gonna have to stay up and talk. But I noticed he kept like eating junk food and drinking nonstop. And I figured, okay, something's going on. I just felt like there was a story here. So it turned out this guy essentially owned his own private CIA. And so he used to work for like all these intelligence agencies like the CIA or the FBI and the DIA and all these things that you don't even hear about. And now he set up his own internal like company that's like a private CIA. And governments from around the world hire him to spy on other people. and or other countries. And he said, we send out like 9,000 checks a year to different people sitting in all these like high level government positions, and so that's how they get information. And so obviously I had a lot of questions, and he was totally trashed at this point. So he was telling me everything, like, I know more about the private affairs of the Nigerian prime minister than I wanted to know. But he told me some interesting things. Like, apparently he was the chief interrogator for the DIA when some a Chinese scientist was apparently accused of stealing nuclear secrets. And I don't know whatever happened with the case, but he was the chief interrogator. And he had to, so I said, how do you tell if someone's lying to you? How do you interrogate people? And by the way, this is gonna relate eventually back to business, but, because it all does. It's all talking and communications related to business in some way or other, which I didn't realize at first, but I realize now. But, so I'm talking to this guy and I asked, how do you tell if someone's lying to you? Like, would you tell? He said this scientist was definitely guilty, even though he never, I think, was convicted or anything like that. And I said, how do you know? How do you know if someone's lying? And first clue is if you ask a question, he would start off asking easy questions like, how's China? Or, you know, what'd you eat for breakfast today? And, you know, you get them answering fast and in like a typical lie detector, I guess, like a machine. But then you start asking more complicated questions, and if the rhythm is not the same, you know something's a little bit off. But one thing he said to me that was very interesting, he said, if someone doesn't answer your question with the direct truth, it means they're lying. So picture this in a relationship. Let's say I ask my girlfriend, oh, where were you last night? And she says, I was out with friends. That means, because I'm paranoid, that means she's probably lying. Because she noticed she didn't answer the question. She didn't say, oh, I was at, you know, Columbia University listening to this class. She said she answered with something that wasn't an answer at all. I was out with friends. She didn't answer where was she. So if you want to know if your boyfriend or girlfriend's cheating, that's the question to ask and see if they're lying. I always do this trick with my kids. How many of you have kids? Does anybody have kids in here? One kid, how old is your kid? 14 months, so you've got a ways to go. So I have an 18-year-old and a 15-year-old. And one trick that always works is anytime they say anything to me, I assume they're lying. Because that's just where we've all been there. Every kid has a good reason and a real reason. And we all did this, and we still do it, but now we're better at it. But I'll give you an example. My daughter says, Daddy, can you take me to the library? I'm gonna study. Oh, what a great reason. But you know there's always a real reason. Of course, the real reason is there's boys or whatever at the library. So that's the classic case. It always works. No matter what my daughters tell me, they're really smart at giving a good reason, and there's always a real reason. So I always try to ask more to get the real reason. This doesn't change as they get older. It's just that when they're kids, when they're 18, it's kind of fun, or when they're 15, it's fun, because it's so obvious, they're just giving a BS reason, and there's another reason deeper. But what's really challenging is when you're in business, and you're negotiating with a customer, or a potential business partner, or you're doing some kind of deal, there's still always a good reason and a real reason. What people say is only kind of like the top of the pyramid, and then there's the huge pyramid underneath. And you have to really listen hard to kind of figure out what that real reason is. And you can't win the negotiation. And win's the wrong word, but I'll use it anyway. You can't win the negotiation if you don't know the real reason for what people are saying. So, and it's really important, because I was just thinking about this the other day. Someone was interviewing me about what do board members do for a company. And I was thinking about it. I'm on a bunch of boards of different companies. I'm invested in a bunch of different companies. And I was thinking about it. Most of the time, we talk not about business, but we talk to each other about relationships. So, which is a really, you would think when you talk about business, you talk about, well, okay, we're gonna build these features for this product, and then we're gonna scale the business in this way, and then this is gonna be our profits, and this is gonna be our losses. All of that stuff with a business kind of takes care of itself. Like I run a business, once a month, somebody tells me what the profits were, and someone tells me what the expenses were, and that's it. That's the only thing I need to know. All the other conversations I have about my business are about, like, how do we convince this guy? What's this guy about? Like, does he have a temper? How do we convince this guy to do X, Y, and Z? How do we, should you talk first? Should I then talk? Like, should it be a good cop, bad cop thing? Like, every conversation's all about how do we, I want to say about relationships, but it's really how to manipulate people. And that's an important part of business. So I'll give you an example. I'm skipping right from prostitution to selling businesses, which is almost the same thing. But so one time I was on the board of a company, and they did the monthly thing. They send around the financials to the board, how much money they lost and how much they made and so on. And I noticed something in the financials, and I was very upset. In fact, I was scared. So I called the CEO, and I said, Rob, you realize, you know, in 6 months, you're gonna, if you continue doing this, you're gonna run out of money. And he said, oh, no problem. In three months, we're gonna go out and raise money from our venture capitalists, and it's not gonna be a problem. And I said, no, you don't understand. You're already out of business. Like, it's already too late to save your business. You're dead. And he's like, what do you mean? And I said, even if you started today trying to raise money, just talking to people, setting up meetings, convincing people, having the second and third meeting, and then getting a commitment of money, and then doing the legal and the paperwork and all of that, and then getting people to wire money, that takes more than 6 months. Even if you start today with the best business in the world, like Airbnb or Uber can't raise money in faster than 6 months, so you're not gonna be able to do it either. And he said, you're absolutely wrong. There's no way. So, there's a problem. I'm on the board, and I have a lot of money invested, and I have other people who invested with me, and here's the CEO, and we disagree. And he thinks I'm a problem now because I'm telling him something that he doesn't want to hear, that he's going to go out of business and personally he's going to go broke. And I'm trying to get him to do something that he doesn't want to do. I'm essentially telling him he's out of business, so which is scary to him. And I have a problem, which is I think he is out of business, and the next 6 months of my life are going to be hell, and then I'm going to have all these friends. I'm going to have to explain why I convinced them to put millions of dollars in this guy's business, and then they lost it, and I did nothing about it. So I had to start thinking, what am I going to do? How am I going to solve all of these different problems here? And how am I going to communicate to this CEO? So I called my business partner, and we started to figure out, okay, who else is on the board? What's their agendas? Some people are so wealthy they could care less about this. Some people also have situations like mine where they're personally, this is important to them. Or they have friends who are in this or whatever. So we figure out who to talk to. Again, it's a fact. We don't have to talk about the money anymore. It's a fact he's already blown it. The CEO has blown it. We know this just from experience. So we don't have to talk about that at all. Which you would think, again, in business, maybe you think about business. You think about, well, how can he get more customers? Or how can he, what venture capitalists we know that could put money in? But there's no, even if you get a new customer the next day, it's 6 months before they pay. So there's so many opportunities for him to go out of business. There's no business solution for him. So what we have to do is figure out personal solutions. So we figure out the right other people I could call, and I get them scared. We figure out the correct strategy is for me to get them scared, and we figure out what bullet points to say to make them as frightened as possible. And then I'd make those calls, and then we arrange for an emergency board meeting, and how do we convince these two rich people to get scared also? And then we get those people, the ones who have the most influence with the CEO, we get them to frighten the CEO. And so it's all about coming up with a, again, it has nothing to do with money, and it has nothing to do with, can he get more customer? And he tried to say, oh, I'm gonna get more customers, I'm gonna raise money. And we just said, it's too late. So finally, we did force him to find an investment bank, and we had to figure out how to talk to the investment bank. Like, this will be good for you. Here are the types of companies you could talk to. We had to figure out what's their agenda? Why would they talk to us? And then we had to figure out what companies they should go to so we can do an emergency fire sale of this company. And the CEO still wouldn't understand. Why are you doing a fire sale? We have 6 months left to go, and there's no fire sale here. And he never, ever, to this day, understood. Even though he himself was dead broke, he was hardly taking a salary, and he had a decent company, he was just gonna go out of business, he didn't have enough money. And so, 6 months later, with three hours left to go before his payroll was gonna be missed because he was out of money, somebody did buy the company, and because of the bank we hired, and the CEO made $12 million. And then he disappeared. Like, I have no idea where he is. Because he hates me. Because I was the one who initially told him he was an idiot. And again, it wasn't throughout the entire process, to be quite frank, I don't even know what his business did for a living. And I was on the board of the company. So all I wanted to understand was how to convince people to do the right thing at different points, because I was scared. And so it was all about convincing people to listen to me and convincing people to then listen to them and kind of scripting out this agenda. The CEO doesn't have to know everything about business. CEO knows about product. CEO can sell his product to customers. Other people had to be involved to kind of make a full business. And again, I don't think a single conversation in this entire six-month period had anything to do with the product development, sales. I have no idea who his customers were. He added customers, he lost customers, whatever. We didn't raise any money because that wouldn't have solved the problem. It was only a fire sale. But the fire sale was enough to make him wealthy. So I'm sure he's happy now, but he, for whatever reason, doesn't talk to me anymore, which is how most of my relationships end, just in case any of you get into a relationship with me. So another time, so I do this podcast, and I have a lot of really interesting people on my podcast, and a lot of it's because I just totally beg for years for people to come on my podcast. Like, I don't know, when I was a kid, none of you are as old as me, but when I was a kid, did anybody read Judy Blume when they were kids? So, okay, some Judy Blume. Judy Blume was, like, great. And so I really wanted her to come on my podcast. And I saw she had a new book coming out. And her publisher was like, she doesn't even know what a podcast is. And I'm like, look, you're going to put her on an 80-city book tour. And just going on my podcast, I'm going to hit more people for her and market her book than your whole 80 cities will do. So she agreed to talk to me. And so I really didn't care about her talking to her at all, except for the fact I was having a relationship problem at the time. And I wanted to ask Judy Blume for advice. Who in the world gets to ask that? She sold 100 million copies of her books to kids and about fifth grade relationships, basically. So I figured, who better to ask for advice than Judy Blume? So I call her up and we're doing the podcast, and in the middle of the podcast, I explain roughly my situation, and she said to me, I want you to listen carefully because do you agree with me? She says, do I represent your entire childhood to you? And I said, yes, because from the first time I read about sex was her book, and from when I was in fourth grade, I read all her books, and it kind of defined my whole understanding of growing up. And so she said, okay. And then she talked on and on, and she gave me advice that was very helpful to me. But the key there was I had been trying to get her on my podcast for 2 years. Like, I tried everything to get her on my podcast because I just want to, I don't, Initially, when I started this podcast, everyone thought I was just going to get business people on. I kind of can't stand business people. They're really boring. And I just want people who are going to really, who have just always fascinated me. And so she was one of them. And so for forever, I was trying to figure out what angle to take to get her on. And so finally, I saw this book coming out, and I was able to work out a strategy to talk to her publicists and her agents and so on to get her on. But then she wants to talk about her book mostly. And this is like every podcast I do. Everybody's got their agenda of what they want to talk about. And my job as an interviewer, and this applies also to business and to anything you do, my job as an interviewer is to get them to not talk about what they want to talk about, but to get them to talk about what I want them to talk about. And that's not always the case. Sometimes what they have to say is interesting, but they have their kind of, they're on like, they do 100 interviews, so they're gonna say the same thing every time. And so how do you listen carefully enough that they say something different to you than what they say to anybody else? And there's all sorts of strategies for that. So I don't know, like, do you guys know who Tony Robbins is? Have you ever read any of Tony Robbins' books? Raise your hand if you read a Tony Robbins book. So he's like this like self-help guy. He's about 8 feet tall and like an enormous, like, he's like this tall. And he's constantly yelling. He's one of those guys, he gives like these seminars to 15,000 people a weekend, and he's just constantly like jumping down and yelling, and a very good guy. But I knew he was gonna say the same thing in his podcast with me that he said to everybody else in his podcast with them. So right in the beginning, I said to him, you know, and we're being recorded already, I said, for everybody listening to this, you've been on this person's podcast, and this person's podcast, and you, Tony, did a great job, so nobody has to listen to my podcast if they want your basic background. They can listen to these other podcasts. And so right from there, he's kind of on guard that he can't say the same stuff. But then he's still saying kind of the same stuff. And so you have to, this is what I've learned, so I've interviewed like hundreds and hundreds of people at that caliber and also at the prostitute caliber and everywhere in between. And you kind of have, everybody kind of doesn't know what they're saying. They don't know that it's the pyramid and that they're talking about, and that there's the hole underneath that they're skipping. So you have to say, when he starts saying something like, well, then President Clinton called me and was asking me about what he should do in this situation. You have to kind of listen for every word and say, and with him, because he was yelling so much, I had to literally yell back, like, stop. And why the hell would President Clinton call you? And so nobody had asked him that, like, because people were afraid to kind of insinuate that maybe he's not important enough, or they didn't want to interrupt him because he's like yelling while he's very passionate while he's talking. And so you kind of have to not be afraid to interrupt. And the reason, this is very uncomfortable. Like one person once told me, if you're listening to somebody and you're already thinking of a response while they're talking, then you're not really listening. And I don't believe that, because when someone's talking, I'm constantly trying to figure out what the hell is this person really saying? And I'm constantly thinking every word almost, what can I ask to understand more what he's saying? It's the only chance I'm gonna get ever to talk to this person. So I need to understand, this is my only chance in life to understand what they just said. So I'm never gonna, it's not like I'm gonna call this guy Tony Robbins tomorrow and say, wait a second, I just wanted to ask you off the record, why would President Clinton call you? He's not even gonna pick up on me, he's already forgotten about me. So I can only ask when he's right there in the middle of his sentence and interrupt him. And I even get like emails about this. Why are you always interrupting the guests? He was about to tell you this big story about President Clinton anyway. And he's already told that story a million times, but I'm never gonna find out what he's done in life to get all these presidents to call him up. I was curious about it. So people always say, write what you know. Have you heard that about writing? Write what you know. And that's actually like really bad writing advice. You never wanna write about what you know. You want to write about what fascinates you, because otherwise you don't care enough to write well about it. So for instance, I wrote a book called The Power of No. It's like, it's how saying no in life can make your life a lot better. And I didn't write this because I was such an expert at saying no. I wrote about it because I constantly was saying yes to all these things I didn't want to do. And I had to learn how to say no. So I figured, okay, if I write a book about saying no, I'm going to learn in this process of writing this book how to better say no and all the benefits of saying no. So it's the same thing with an interview or investing or business. You've got to stop everything. The world has to stop when someone just says something that fascinates you, but they're moving forward. So a business answer, a business case of this, I'll give two. Let's say you're thinking of investing in a company, and they're some kind of like perfume logistics company, and they explain, this is how we make a perfume, and we do it in this factory because it's BSU certified or whatever. I want to know, what is it? How do you get certified? How much money does that cost? Well, can you change one ingredient? So you have to, and then sometimes they keep talking in their jargon because they don't know how to, nobody knows how to present. So you have to say, hold on, just speak to me as if I'm the most stupid, naive person here, and just take it down to the fifth grade level. And then they start telling you, they like you at that point because you're being really honest. Like, I'm saying I'm stupid. So they like teaching, and they like it when you're honest about your vulnerability and so on. And then B, then finally they're able to start explaining at a level you can understand. I will tell you, most people who graduate business school and then go on to be investors and go into these meetings, no one asks any questions. I very rarely have seen anybody ask good questions because most people just aren't really listening, and they're not really trying to understand what's happening. So one time, I was doing a podcast. It's going to sound like I'm always name dropping, like, oh, Judy Blume, this, that. But I only interview people on my podcast who are good enough to name drop because I like doing that. So I was interviewing Coolio, the rapper. Do you know Coolio? Gangster's Paradise, best R&B song of 1995 on Billboard. So it's 20 years ago, but I love the song, so I wanted him on my podcast. So I said, what have you been doing lately? You know, you kind of had this song in 1995, and then you died or something. And he said, well, first, you know, I had some cocaine issues, and then I started getting into cooking. And I'm like, hold on a second. What do you mean you had some cocaine issues? And so he started going into like how he got addicted to drugs and coke and all this. And then he said, but then I got over it, and I started getting into being a chef and cooking. And I'm like, hold on, how do you get over, you know, your drug addiction? Like, people don't know, you know, this is something that addiction is something that 100 million people in the country want to figure out how to get over. And he's just glossing over it because he figures, okay, he got over this, and then he's doing this. I wanted to know, how did you get over these issues? And then why did you start cooking? What drove that? And like, I don't want to know like what he's doing, what show he's on and stuff like what, you know. So now I got a chance to learn how he got over like the roughest period in his life. And then I learned all about like him growing up in poverty and not getting enough food. It was a special thing when his mom would cook and he would help her cook. And so it was really like this way of connecting with his mom and his youth that he got into cooking again. And so then you really get people's real stories when you're really listening and you feel yourself being curious a little bit, just say what you're curious about. Now, in business, if someone said what he said, you wouldn't want to do business with them. So this is my big problem. So one time I was in Florida, I had dinner with a friend of mine. He was a big shareholder in another company I was on the board of, a billion revenues company, and he was the biggest shareholder. So this was like a legit company. They were they helped people find jobs. So maybe up to 1 million people found jobs through this company that I was on the board of. So it was an impactful company. And I had dinner with him, and we're hanging out and talking. And he said, I just have to tell you something. I just got out of rehab. I was in rehab for a week. And I asked some basic questions like, how's the relationship with your wife? Are you okay now? But what I really should have done was immediately, well, before I get into that, I'll tell you what happened. So about a month later, I'm gonna ask questions while I tell these stories. Anyone watch the TV show Billions? I'm gonna name drop again. So Billions on Showtime, great show. I highly recommend it. Before the show was on Showtime, I was on the set watching it being filmed. In the middle of the day, I get this message, emergency board meeting right now, like 10 minutes. And so I had to leave the building for a little bit, and I get on the call, and I find out that this guy who I had just had dinner with, the IRS was getting set to arrest him or something because he owed $90 million. And because so much of his assets were tied up with the company, the bank of the company didn't want to help us anymore meet our payroll. So that means, you know, we pay 1 million people every 2 weeks. So that means we were out of business within, probably it was about 5 days at that point. A billion revenue company. And we had this board meeting. I'm like, I don't understand. 90 million, we could just sell off a piece of this business and give them their 90 million, and then this guy can owe us it for his taxes. Or you know, the bank, the IRS, everything was kind of linked together. And there was actually no solution. I kept coming up with solution after solution. It was just too late. The bank locked the management out. They put all of their people in the company. And the bank is one of the top three banks in the world. The bank took all of our customers, and they gave our customers to our competitors, who were also customers of the bank. So they basically just gave away a billion of our revenues, and within a couple of weeks, we had to declare bankruptcy. We were a profitable company with a billion in revenues, and within 5 days, just gone. So while I was on the set of this show, I basically had this call where I personally lost $9 million worth of my stock in this company, and it was horrible. So what I should have done, I don't even know what I could have done, but as soon as this guy told me about his rehab, I should have alerted all the other members of the board. I should have figured out what other potential issues or consequences this could have. And I should have sold all my stock in the company because this disaster was happening. It's like any relationship. Once, let's say in the beginning of your relationship, you're all like in love, and there's one thing you don't like. You don't like how the person chews or whatever. That problem is never going to get better. Like, you're only going to hate how they chew more and more over the next few years or whatever. So the same thing happens in business. This guy just got out of rehab. Who knows what other problems he had. Any problems he had, and he was the largest shareholder of a company that I was heavily involved in. So I depended on him. So his problem and my problem with this company were only going to get bigger and bigger. I didn't listen well enough. I listened as a friend, but not as a business person. And so that's how critical, like that's a life-changing amount. And that's how critical it was that I should have listened even further to what he was saying. You know why I didn't listen that well that night? Now that I think about it, I'm just kind of psychoanalyzing myself while I'm up here. My wife at the time didn't come with me to the dinner, and I was upset at her about that. And so I wasn't really fully paying attention to this guy who I had so much of my wealth tied up in him. I was thinking about how I was kind of angry about something else. And so I didn't put my full attention on him. I didn't listen to that every word, what I was curious about. Like, I didn't even ask him why he had gone to rehab, like what happened. What, you know, when someone goes to rehab, it's not like they just sort of say, okay, I'm going to Disneyland because it'll be fun. It's like something bad happened, the police were called or whatever, and now he has to go to rehab. So I didn't really ask like the more important, deeper questions, which are always there in any significant relationship. So shame on me once. Actually, that would have been shame on me the 18th time, but it was a big shame. But so I get this, I have this board call, and then what am I going to do? I'm out in the middle of nowhere on this TV set, and I realized I was going to lose all this money, and I had another 6 hours to stay in this shoot while they were shooting this scene. And I go back upstairs and I said, you know what? There's nothing I can do. So I decided to just totally focus on learning everything I could about shooting a TV show. Because what are you going to do the rest of the day? Just start crying? Or are you going to make use of your time in the short amount of time you have? I'm never going to be on the set of a TV show again, so I might as well learn as much as possible. So again, it's not so much, this is not as much a lesson here on listening. That lesson I failed, but I wasn't gonna, even losing a large amount of money, I wasn't gonna let it ruin a valuable experience for me. And, you know, paying attention to the director and the writers and how they were, and the actors and what they were doing that I had never seen before. So it ended up being a good day. And I explained later to the writers what had happened. And they were like, oh my God, we were looking for you. We thought you were just in the bathroom for a really long time. We had no idea what happened to you. And then you came back and it seemed like you enjoyed the rest of the day. But it was just a hellish phone call. And then a hellish next few days. And heck, I got a email from my lawyer today because people are still suing this guy and documents are getting subpoenaed and whatever. This is 3 years ago. So listening better would have saved me a lot. I'll tell you another situation that happened. Everything's situation. So you're in business long enough. I've started like 20 businesses, maybe three of them worked out, 17 of them failed horribly. I'm invested in a lot of businesses. So there's one company I started fairly recently, a couple years ago, and one of my partners, he was a shareholder with me, he calls me up and I suddenly occurred to me, this guy is a raving lunatic. He starts accusing me of stealing and doing all the stuff that I never done. I don't know what his actual agenda was, but he was like really angry at me. And anytime I would say anything, he would start screaming. And so then afterwards, I did the usual thing happened, which is a bunch of phone calls happen all around the actual phone call. And again, nobody's discussing business. We're all just discussing, well, what's going on in this guy's life? What's going on in, you know, his other partners or his other friends or whatever? What's happening here? What's the real story? Because there's always a real story. And we couldn't really figure it out. We were just taking guesses. So I decided, okay, I'm not gonna make this a problem. He was threatening to like do all sorts of stuff, like kick me out and not let me take my share or whatever. He was threatening all these crazy things that I didn't know whether he could do or not. Like, I'm not a lawyer, and in business you find basically people can get away. A bad actor, not necessarily a bad person, but someone who has some motive different from yours can basically get away with anything. And just because you can call a lawyer doesn't mean that's going to do you any good. Just because there's contracts doesn't mean nothing. Every contract I've seen has always, 100% of the time, gets renegotiated at some point, or people break it. And then what are you going to do when someone breaks a contract? Are you going to sue them and go to a court for 10 years? It never happens, or it happens very rarely, and it's very stressful. So he was threatening all these things that were very stressful to me. And I had to decide, well, what am I going to do? Am I going to be stressed every day? I have a bad problem here, because this is like kind of at that time the main focus of my life. So, you know, Sheryl Sandberg wrote this book, Lean In. I decided to lean into the problem. I said, okay, this is a problem, but I'm going to make this problem work out better for me. I'm never going to talk to him again, okay? Even though he's going to be calling and he's going to be emailing, I'm never going to ever interact with him again, unless there's just a necessary yes or no for big decisions. So, and this is in general how I operate with anybody who is angry at me. I have no idea why someone's angry at me. Any anger, think about all the times someone's been angry at you. Maybe they're justified, maybe they're not. but it's never about their justification. They're always deep down afraid of something. So this is what, you know, I've seen after just hundreds and hundreds of times of people being angry at me in business or wherever. It's not that they're angry at something I did, it's that they're afraid of something. So this guy, turns out, there's a good reason and a real reason, this guy was having his own problems in his own business. So he was afraid he was gonna maybe have some financial difficulties because of his own business, and perhaps he was taking this out on me. I have no idea, but that's one of the guesses. So I can't solve his problem for him. I can't solve his fears for him. But what I can do is make the situation better for me somehow. And so rather than try to talk to him or, you know, do some bullshit thing like, oh, let's go out to dinner and work out our difficulties, that never works out. That's like a Band-Aid when you need like open heart surgery. So I decided to do what I typically do with angry people is open heart surgery. Again, life is short, and the people who are angry at you, it's never like the neighbor down the street. It's your family member, it's your business partner, it's your employees. It's the people close to you that are really angry, that you get angry back and you fight. And so if my neighbor like yells at me, I'm like, all right, have a nice day. Like, I'm never gonna talk to you again. I don't know who you are. But if this guy is angry at me, I need to deal with it. So the way I deal with it, and the way I think in general it should be dealt with, is to eliminate them completely from your life. And, you know, or until they kind of change colors and they're not, and they deal with their fears and they're not as angry, because you can't really solve their life. It's hard enough solving your own life, you can't solve two lives. And when they're angry at you, it's like they're outsourcing their fears to you as well. I've got my own fears to deal with. I can't handle someone's outsourced fears. So I basically called that guy's lawyer and I said, I'm gonna buy his shares and I'm gonna buy them for this dirt cheap price. And the guy was so angry at me, he immediately agreed. And now I have a job. So I go to you know, I do what you do in any kind of business transaction. I go to I write down the first 20 people I can think of, and I call them all up, and I go and visit them and explain what I do and explain why this is a good price and explain what happened and get them to buy the person out. And so that's a deal that I fortunately just closed, and someone bought this guy's shares. I haven't talked to him since that day. He was angry at me. And now I've got like a much better business partner that's been working out, you know, 100 times better. And again, I could have spent the past 8 or 9 months just arguing with this person and trying to prove that he was wrong and trying to prove that I'm right. But then I would still have him as a partner and we'd still be arguing all the time. And instead, rather than try to prove that I was right, I said, whatever. And I immediately tried to figure out the financial ways to disconnect from him. If I didn't have a financial relationship with him, I just would have stopped returning his calls completely. But I had a financial relationship, so I had to figure out how to end that. And by leaning into the problem and assuming that if I get really proactive, I can actually make life better for myself anyway, that's how I solved an angry person problem. And this happens all the time. In every single business, someone's gonna be angry at you and bad things are gonna happen and relationships are gonna end and customers are gonna fire you and employees are gonna get pissed off. So I don't know what most of you do or how many of you wanna eventually run your own company. So, okay, you want to run your own company. Anyone else want to run your own company? It's a very interesting thing to do, but it's also very painful because what happens the first when you run your own company, most of your employees don't really like you that much because you're taking, the whole nature of being an employee is that you're doing X amount of dollars worth of work and someone else is taking the bulk of that money and putting it in their pocket, which is your boss. And their boss, and their boss, all these people up the chain are taking pieces of every dollar of value you create, which is fine. Maybe you're doing the job, you're an employee for a lot of reasons, because you want to learn, you want to build a network, you want to get experience, so you're getting value in other ways as an employee. But ultimately, the people who are making the most money are the people above you. And so one thing I've noticed with employees is that usually there's some employee gets what I call the disease. And so the disease is where you can see viscerally this person hates his boss, me, or whoever. And if someone has the disease and they're angry like this all the time and there's nothing you can do, you can't pay them off to not be angry at you. Actually, if you give them a raise, they'll even be angrier. And there's studies that show this. Like money solves zero problems in business, ironically. So the worst thing about the disease is that everybody takes cigarette breaks or they're out in the stairwell talking to each other. The disease spreads like a virus. Everybody's contagious. So the one person who hates you starts getting everyone else to hate you. And so again, how do you deal with this situation? As soon as someone gets the disease, there's no questions asked, you have to fire them, because they're never gonna not have it. It's a terminal disease and it's chronic and it only gets worse. They'll eventually die from it and it spreads to everyone else in your company. So anytime someone gets the disease, they're fired. And it sounds brutal, but it actually works out for the best. They'll get a better job, hopefully, with somebody that they like. Your other employees remain motivated and happy in the job, and you stay happy in your job, which is being the boss of all these people, and it makes it easier to motivate people. I'm constantly worried that when I think about my employees, I don't think about whether they're doing a good job or not. I'm thinking about whether they feel motivated to get out of bed in the morning. So I'm concerned about two things with employees. Are they motivated to get out of bed in the morning? And at the end of the day, do they call their parents and said, "Mom, I just had the best possible day"? So if those two things, if their day is bridged by those two things, then they're gonna do a good job and I never have to worry about what they're doing for their job. And so how do you do that? How do you make someone motivated? Well, their motivation is never gonna be this guy James needs to make as much money as possible. Like that's not their motivation at all. So in 100% of cases. So you have to figure out why are you doing the company you're doing. For anybody who wants to start a company, what purpose outside of your improving your life does this company have to exist? Is it better than let's say you have a landscaping company. Is it better than every other landscaping company? Do you use better lawnmowers? Do you have better, somehow a landscape artist working for you? Like, how are you better than everyone else? What's your reason and vision and purpose for doing what you're doing as opposed to all your competitors? Your goal is you don't want any competitors. You want your vision to be so interesting and inspirational that you have actually no competitors. Competition's horrible for business, which competition is essentially anti-capitalism, because it shouldn't be the case that we all kind of divide up this pie. I want the entire pie for myself. And your employees then have to see your vision. You have to communicate your vision, and your employees then understand how they're going to benefit, how the customers are going to benefit, how they're going to help society and so on, and they're motivated to get out of the bed in the morning, and then they do a good job and they have the best day, and then they call their parents. So, you know, that's the only thing I think about. Like I'm a horrible CEO and manager. So whenever I'm involved in a company, the first thing I do is I hire a CEO to do everything I don't want to do. So in my current company that I manage, or the one I'm involved in the most, I call the CEO and I don't say, "How is this person doing at their job?" I say, "Is this person happy? Do you think they're unhappy at their job?" And then he has to find out and report back. And so we measure sort of P&L by how happy and unhappy everyone is. Because I know if everyone's motivated and happy, then great things are gonna happen. So again, it's all about listening to what somebody's problems are and looking at all the clues for what their issues are. There's so many things that where listening properly has like basically ruined my life or saved my life. And whether I'm interviewing someone in a podcast and really trying to say, well, what they just said something that I don't understand, so I have to understand it a little bit more. And I kind of stop them and again unpack it to try to understand. In the biggest example is, so I talked to Scott Adams. You know, he writes, he makes the cartoon Dilbert. But one thing that Scott Adams did in a year ago that was very interesting was he wrote on his blog that Donald Trump was going to win the presidency. And this was before the nomination, before Donald Trump was nominated. And so I got Scott on the podcast, and I'm like, how did you know that Donald, why were you the only guy to, he predicted it so accurately. There was still 16 people running for the nomination. Donald Trump wasn't even ahead in the polls then. And he predicted it so accurately, everything that happened 100% of the way, a year in advance, that I had to find out why he did that. Or how did he know? And so Scott Adams starts talking to me, well, I've taken hypnosis classes, and I saw Donald Trump was the best hypnotist I've ever seen. He's using these classic mass hypnosis techniques that I had never seen, and then the flyover states, this, that. But I had to stop him, because I didn't know, what do you mean hypnosis? Like, is that when somebody holds a watch in front of your eyes and you go to sleep? Like, just really basic question. I didn't know what he meant by the word hypnosis. And so he said, no, that never actually happens in hypnosis. That's kind of it happens in the movies in hypnosis. I didn't know that. And so then I said, well, what did you learn in hypnosis? You said you took all these hypnosis classes. What are some techniques? And he said, you can use hypnosis for anything. You can even, and he's telling me this, we're recording everything, it's a podcast, so you can listen to it, it's all public. He's saying, I even use hypnosis to get my girlfriends to have like multiple orgasms when they've never had it before. And I'm like, okay, I'm not gonna interrupt you on that one, but I'm gonna come back to it. So he started just listing all these different techniques that Donald Trump uses for hypnosis, and I didn't understand any of them. So I had to really, because I never heard of this, so I had to really understand what he was saying about, you know, how does Donald Trump use visual cues? Like he said, Donald Trump uses visual cues all the time that no one's ever used before. And I said, can you give me an example? And I actually forget the example now, but I wrote an article about it. He reframes the conversation in this real, he said something like, he said, I have a lot, Donald Trump kept saying, I have a lot of stamina. And then he kept comparing himself to Jeb Bush. And he said, like, you know, Jeb is like, you know, look at that weakling Jeb Bush. And so you have this odd visual cue that you think of every time now you look at Jeb Bush as a weakling. And no one's ever called like a presidential candidate a weakling. Or he would refer to like someone's fingers or whatever. Someone asked him like, what do you feel about the way you treat Megyn Kelly? And he said, you know, I never treat a woman bad unless it's Rosie O'Donnell. So now we're thinking like about Rosie O'Donnell, who doesn't necessarily have a high approval rating or whatever. So he always would kind of fall into these visual cues to get people off the main topic. And so he described, there's one thing he said that was really fascinating. He said at one point in the summer, Hillary also was using her hypnosis game, like her team was on it. And so they had, you know, trigger happy Donald. Do you want Donald Trump at write his fat fingers at the nuclear codes? And Scott was like, I was nervous that my prediction wasn't going to come true because that was working on people. But then the Hillary campaign leaked this Billy Bush story about Donald Trump grabbing around, and he said that killed Hillary's campaign immediately because it turned out most voters didn't care about that. They actually cared about the nuclear one instead. But the huge headlines was every day this Billy Bush recording, and suddenly Donald Trump skyrocketed up in the polls, and that was the end of the game. And so he said the entire battle of this election was about both sides trying to use a better hypnosis game to win kind of voters that were on the fence. And at the end of the day, Trump used so many different techniques, and Scott went through all of them. But I didn't know any of these things. And I didn't, even when he first explained it, I didn't understand. So I kept getting him to back up, and because I was never going to get a chance to talk to him again about it. And it was just so, by interrupting and listening to every word and making sure you question yourself, do I understand everything he's saying, or am I just, oh, hypnosis, I kind of know what that means. Are you just kind of saying that to yourself, or do you really know what it means? And you kind of have to be honest with yourself in order to listen to someone else and say, do I understand this? Can I repeat that? I want to use these techniques to hypnotize people potentially. Can I repeat? Can I learn from what he's saying to me? And so if you can't, then you're not really listening. So that's how I'll define listening, is if you're not really learning something new from what the person's saying, then you're just kind of like saying, oh yeah, I remember what that word, I've heard it before, then you're not really listening. So, you know, so these are a bunch of examples. I have, you know, my worst examples are when my very first business, I was making websites for a living. This is in the 90s, so nobody knew how to make a website. And you can probably tell by the way I look, the kind of websites I made. I made all the websites for every gangster rap label, record label. So it was sort of what we were known for. And it was very critical to listen to our customers because we didn't really know anything about them. What I found was all the ways by listening how I can get every single job, no problem, against all my competition, because I wanted to have no competition in this space. Turned out everybody had their own cues for what a bribe would mean. And so I would essentially like bribe to get clients, and it worked, it was great. And then I knew it wasn't gonna work forever, so we sold the company. And at some point after that, because I didn't know anything about money, I made a lot of money, enough money to just retire at that point of age 30 or however old I was. And almost immediately, I lost all the money and went totally bankrupt. I bought all this crap, I spent it on all these things, I did every disastrous thing you could think of, and I went totally broke. I lost my house, ended up losing my family in the long run, ended up losing everything. People kept trying to give me advice. People who were smarter about money kept trying to give me advice, but I wouldn't listen. I thought, oh, I'm a smart guy because I just sold a company, and I thought that intelligence kind of applied to other areas of life, but it doesn't. Money just kind of magnifies was already inside you, and at that time, inside of me was just this arrogant little douchebag or whatever, and probably still there, so I have to keep it under control. But I ended up losing everything, and the only way I would make it back, and it happened repeatedly, but the only way I would ever make money back is talking to people all the time who I admired and wanted to model myself after, and figuring out what their problems were in life, and then building businesses around those problems. Because if someone is, let's say, a rich billionaire, has a major problem, and I can build something that solves that problem, some of his money is gonna transfer over to me at some point. And so again, that's not about asking all the basic questions like, how do you know if an idea is good, blah, blah, blah. I really want to listen to where they're scared and where they are having a problem. And again, it doesn't sound like it has nothing to do with money. I'm not thinking about how much it's going to cost me to build a product. If I can solve a billionaire's problem, or if I can solve the problems of like a million people or even like 1,000 people, I'll have no problem raising the money to do it, or at least doing it in some way that's super cheap. But the key is listening to find out what the problems are, and then avoiding everybody who gets in your way, i.e. the angry people in your life who we all have. So it took a long time to kind of sort of finally realized all the mistakes I was making that was costing me to lose money. It happened like 3 times. I started businesses, sold them, and then lost all my money, and finally lost everything else. And it took me a long time to come back from that and realize, what am I doing wrong, and what am I doing right on the way up, and what am I doing wrong on the way down? And what I realized on the way up is I was eliminating immediately any angry person in my life. I was building great relationships with people, and I was listening to them. And on the way down, not only was I listening to them, I then go home and either write what I learned, all the 10 ideas that I learned, or write 10 ideas how I can help them with their business more. And then I would present the ideas back to them. I did this every single day. I still do it. So that means I write down 10 ideas a day, 3,650 ideas a year. And I've been doing this since 2002. And most of the time, I'll present it to other people. So I have visited Amazon, Google, LinkedIn, Facebook, and just shared my ideas freely. Because again, if I help Facebook solve some problem, Facebook's worth a huge amount of money. Some small amount might come back to me in some way, or I might build up some good relationship that will help me in some way in the future, or some network in the future. But so finally, by learning these things, I'm able to now be a little better. Although again, this, you know, losing $9 million by not listening to this guy who had been in rehab, you know, still the problems still happen all the time. You just have to then fall back onto what you know works rather than regret the problems.